Welcome to Module 10. Having introduced the notion of a homeomorphism and having studied some subsets of Rn, let us now do various types of equivalences coming out of the metric. But we will do it in general now. First of all, the broad aim of topology as a discipline is to classify all topological spaces into homeomorphism types. What does that mean? It means that you must describe a set of topological spaces such that any two members of this set belong to distinct homeomorphism types. That is, they are not homeomorphic to each other. And second thing is, if anybody gives you any topological space, then there must be a member in your list which is homeomorphic to that given space. That is the meaning of classification. Classification of topological spaces up to homeomorphism. However, this such a task seems to be, you know, seemingly impossible. How can you list, you know, all possible homeomorphism types? How can you is not the answer. Lot of very difficult things have been achieved by people, right? But here is something mathematically established that this is an impossible task. I can't elaborate that right now because it involves deep logic, deep group theory, and sufficiently deep, not so deep, but beyond you, of algebraic topology also. Okay, so beyond this, I can't say anything more than that. It is impossible to classify all topological spaces. So that sounds rather a negative result, and you may momentarily get disappointed. Oh, then why should we study topological spaces and so on? That is not the case. There is no worry for that because there are enough problems other than the central problem or the broad aim, whatever you wanted. Many related problems are there in topology, the solutions of which will be tractable. Okay, tractable means what? You can, it just looks like you can try it, solve it, sometimes solve it also, sometimes partial answers and so on, but the final answers will be useful. Okay, so therefore we should not get disappointed. That is the whole idea. Okay, let us begin with a definition now, a formal definition which looks like not a mathematical definition. A property P. What do you mean by property P? That itself is a difficult thing to explain. So take it as a, you know, just with a pinch of salt. Just take it as it is. A property P of topological spaces is called a topological property or a topological invariant if every homeomorphism preserves it. A little more elaborately, suppose you have a function f from x1 tau 1 to x2 tau 2, which is a homeomorphism. Then x1 tau 1 has property p, should imply x2 tau 2 has it, and conversely, x1 tau 1 satisfies p if and only if x2 tau 2 satisfies it. What are x1 and x2? They are homeomorphic to each other. So that is the meaning of that P is a topological property. So such a thing is called a topological invariant also. Let me give you some examples, then only you may be understanding. Topological invariants are very useful in distinguishing topological types. What do you mean by type? You know, you have seen that homeomorphism defines an equivalence relation. So these are equivalence classes. Okay. Given two topological spaces, you find a property P which is satisfied by one of them, but not the other. Then obviously they will be in different classes. They cannot be homeomorphic. So this is the way you can distinguish the topological types somewhat easily. Of course, you may find that this property is satisfied by both of them. That doesn't prove that the two spaces are homeomorphic, because there may be some other property which is not satisfied. You may go on listing all your known properties satisfied by both the sides. Still, it will not prove that they are homeomorphic. To prove that something is homeomorphic, somehow you have to produce. That is the, you know, that is the only way. Like we did, first we showed all balls are homeomorphic to each other. Then we showed that one single ball, namely of radius 1, is homeomorphic to the whole of R, whole of Rn. Now you can combine the two. So that this is the kind of proof you have to produce in proving that given two spaces are homeomorphic. Okay. Just topological types will not help in that case. Nevertheless, so they have half the way they come, namely distinguished topological type, they are helpful. Okay. So before going further, I'll take this opportunity to define two things, but I will meet them much later. Okay. Take a function from x1 tau 1 to x2 tau 2. We say this is an open mapping. I told you while defining continuous mappings, there is such a thing also. Now I am defining that. It's called an open mapping if it takes open sets into open sets. That's all. F need not be continuous. Okay. If F inverse takes open sets to open sets, then it's defined as continuous function. Remember that. U implies tau 1 should imply FU inside tau 2. Similarly, I can define a closed mapping also. Namely, say K is a subset here. X1 minus K is inside tau 1 should imply X2 minus FK inside tau 2. Which just means that F of K is closed inside tau 1 should imply FK is closed inside tau 2. Remember, closed sets are defined by taking the complements are inside open sets. Okay? Yeah. So a homeomorphism is a continuous bijection which is open as well as closed. So this is one way why open mappings and closed mappings are important. That is why I have introduced it here. You look at this one. Take a continuous function. What is it? Open subsets in the domain, codomain, inverse of that will be open. Now suppose F is a bijection, then that, what does that mean? That means F inverse function is open mapping, right? Similarly, if suppose F is both open and continuous, then it will imply that F inverse is continuous. So therefore, it will be homeomorphic. Similarly, if F is open as well as a closed mapping, then also it will happen, because you can see that the continuity can be defined in terms of closed sets also, just by De Morgan law. So I have made you that lots of these things you can change from open sets to closed set by De Morgan law. So a function is continuous if every closed set in the domain, in the codomain, the inverse image is closed. Okay. So if F is a bijection, then F inverse makes sense as a function. Otherwise, F inverse of a set always makes sense. As a function, F inverse makes sense first of all, and it will be continuous because F is a closed map. Therefore, you take a continuous function. If it's open, it's already homeomorphic. Continuous bijection. Similarly, a continuous bijection, which is also a closed mapping, is a homeomorphism. Okay. So why sometimes it is easy to handle closed sets, sometimes it is easy to handle open set, that depends upon the situations. That's why we should have all these concepts clear to us. Now we will come to metric spaces wherein there are other equivalences, other notions of equivalences. Just like we have in your school geometry, you have congruent triangles as well as similar triangles and so on, right? They are both equivalences. If one triangle is congruent to another triangle, the another one is congruent to third one, then the first one is congruent to the third one, and so on. We know that congruence as well as similarity are equivalence relations, right? Similar to that, we will have different notions of equivalences here, but they are all metric related. So let us start. Take two metric spaces, Xi, Di. We say they are topologically equivalent if the underlying topological spaces, Xi, tau Di, they have the same homeomorphism type. That means there is a homeomorphism between them. Okay, that is one thing, namely topological type, topological equivalence. The second one, we say x1d1 is similar to x2d2. If you have a bijection from x1 to x2 and two positive real numbers c1 and c2 such that, you know, this d2 distance between fx and fy is trapped between d1 distances between x and y by these constants. C1 times d1 is less than or equal to d2 of fx, fy, less than equal to c2 times d1 again. Okay? C1 and c2 must be positive real numbers. If C1 and C2 are 1, what is the meaning of these? They are all equal. Okay, that is a very strong thing. Of course, that also we take that is an isometry. So we will come to that also. First of all, why this similarity is an equivalence relation? You see, this looks like one way I have defined F from X1 to X2. But it's a bijection, okay? So there is a map F inverse from X2 to X1. Then I can write F inverse here and XY I take now instead X2. Then what should I take? C1, C1 now, C into C1, I have to take D2, D2 here, D2 of XY, right? And here also D2 of XY, what should I take? You just look at this one, what should I take? Bring C1 here, it is 1 by C1. So then D1 of, I can write this as F of A, F of B, F inverse of F inverse B, and this will become AB, right? So work it out. I have already indicated how to do that, okay? So you have to use 1 by C1 and 1 by C2, okay, in correct places. And write down a similar thing for F inverse. That will show you that the similarity here is what? Is symmetric. Okay. Then you have to show if F from X2, Y, X1 to X2, then from another G from X2 to X3, and there will be C1 prime and C2 primes and so on. So you have to get a G composite F from X1 to X3 as a similarity. that will show you transitivity. Of course, I can take identity map here and C1 equal to C2 equal to 1, that will give you that identity map is a similarity. So therefore, this similarity, having a similar map, having a similarity like this, a bijection, okay, is an equivalence relation. Okay, you have to do a little bit of verification. So that I am leaving it as an exercise to you, but I have already indicated it and given you hint enough. Okay. So this equivalence relation is stronger than the first one. Why? Because as soon as we have this one, you will see that F is continuous. Okay. So this part will give you F is continuous. So that part will give you F is, F inverse is continuous. Therefore, it is homeomorphism. Similarity already implies topological equivalence. So it is similar to, it is, you know, a stronger equivalence here. So that implies the weaker equivalence. That's all. Okay. But they are different is what I have to ensure you. That we haven't yet seen. Okay, let's go ahead. So I already told you, if you put C1 equal to C2, what do you get? You will get that distance between fx and fy, the d2 distance, is equal to distance between x and y, the points that which you started with. Okay, so such a thing is called isometry. So if it's a bijection, f is a bijection, that is already there. The distance between x and y is preserved under f d2 of fx, fy. It is equal to that. Okay. If there is such an isometry, then you will call x1 d1 isometric to x2 d2. This is very easy to see that this is a equivalence relation. Okay. Whereas in the similarity, you have to work a little hard. Okay. So I want to caution you that some authors may have different names for these things. Okay. So be careful to read their definition before answering their questions or whatever. Clearly, isometry implies similar, and similar implies topological equivalence. So there are three concepts which you have now, starting with metric spaces. One is stronger than the other. This implies this, this implies that. But are they really stronger? Maybe this will also imply that, then they will be equivalent, no? So let us see that. You may notice that a self-isometry of Rn is nothing but a rigid motion. But now, by now, you must have at least read and tried the exercise on rigid motion, then only you will understand this remark, okay? A rigid motion was defined as what? Any function which preserves a distance like this. There was no condition of bijection. The only thing is the domain and codomain were both assumed to be Rn. There is no need. You can assume this one to be anything, any topological space, but the same topological space on this side. Any metric space and same metric space on this side also. Okay, rigid motions are usually within a metric space. Take x1 d1 to x1 d1, a map such that distance between xy equal to distance between fx, fy for our xy. Automatically, you can check that it is injective. But ontoness is an exercise. First of all, you don't know that it's onto and so on. Okay. So that was the exercise. So this is even stronger than a rigid motion when x1 and x2 are the same. x1, d1, x2, d2 must be also equal to d1. So it's not different. Then the word rigid motion is used. A rigid motion is a weaker notion than this one. Okay. Then the isometry. isometry is definitely isomorphic. Only thing is, this is valid for between any two metric spaces. Okay, so here is a theorem. Take two metric spaces which are similar to each other, then they are homeomorphic to each other. I already told you that. I will elaborate it on that one. Namely, start with a bijection and C1, C2 positive such that this is true for every XY. Right? So that is the definition of similarity. I have to show from this one that F is continuous and F inverse is also continuous. We claim that F itself is a homeomorphism. Then it will follow that X1 and X2 are homeomorphic. That's all. Okay. So we have to prove both F and F inverse are continuous because bijection is already given. Notice that condition 11 can be broken up into two parts, namely this latter part, D2 fx fy is less than or equal to D2 of, sorry, C2 times D2 of D1 of xy for every xy inside x1. Okay. Second part, you take the inverse here, D1 of F1 inverse A, right, F inverse of A into F inverse of B, xy equal to this one. Okay. Bring C1 on this side, 1 by C1 of, so D2 of now, F of that will be A comma B for every AB inside X2. Okay, I am cleverly writing this using the definition, using the fact that F is a bijection, so F inverse makes sense. So suppose you have these two conditions, you can give back this condition. So I am writing this condition, one condition is equivalent to these two conditions here. Okay, it is broken up into two parts, right? Once you have that, by the symmetry, if I prove this implies F is continuous, automatically this will imply F inverse is continuous. Okay, so this 12 and 13, these two conditions are there. Suppose this 12 implies F is continuous, then the other one is also continuous. So what is here given? So how do you prove continuity of F? Given epsilon, there exists a delta, blah, 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 right? That is what you have to do. So what? Whenever distance between this is less than delta, this must be less than epsilon. If this is less than delta, this entire thing will be less than C2 times delta. So I have to only say that C2 times delta is less than epsilon, then this will be less than epsilon. So that's what I have to do here. Given epsilon positive, choose delta such that delta times C2 is epsilon, or delta equal to epsilon by C2. Then D1 of xy less than delta will imply D2 of fxfy here. If this is less than delta, is C2 delta, which is epsilon. This is less than epsilon. Okay, over. All right. So one equivalence relation other than homeomorphism you have studied, in fact, two of them. But one we have shown that similarity implies homeomorphism. The other one is easy, right? Because it's a special case. Isometry, if you take C1 equal to C2 equal to 1 here, you get to similarity. So isometry is equal, implies similarity. Okay, so next time we will see that homeomorphism does not imply similarity and similarity does not imply symmetry. Okay, so we will do it next time. Thank you.